Hi, Ray. We've known each other for many years.
We have indeed.
I know what you do and where you live, but our audience doesn't. So will you please let them know, like, your full name and what is it that you do?
How do you do, everyone? I'm Ray Zimmerman. I'm an investment banker by trade. Spent most of my career in the M&A and IPO markets. I'm now semi-retired, and I have enjoyed for the past 15 years coming out to Sasha's conference. My main activities these days are angel investing my own funds and getting close to companies that we can make money off of and also have a bit of fun at the same time, which again brings me back, Sasha, to why I'm here. This is my annual excuse to come see beautiful California with all the, not just the beautiful weather, but the beautiful new ideas.
Yeah, that's
which
right.
California and Silicon Valley are famous for, and which sometimes are lacking in other parts of the world.
Well, we'll get to that. How do you select the companies you work with, you invest into?
You know,
Where do you find them? How will you evaluate that first moment when you decide I want to follow up with this founder or that founder?
Yeah. Well, having spent a number of years at 3i, which is one of the UK's, if not Europe's, largest private equity firm. We were all children of our own education, are we not? And so the way I feel about new companies these days is exactly the way I believe I was taught to look at companies, which is there are three key elements. You've got market, you've got management, and you've got money.
Wait. They come to you for money.
Correct.
So they need to understand their market. They need to have a good management.
That's right. And then they need to be financeable.
Yeah, but that decision you make.
Correct. That's my contribution to it.
That's your contribution to it. But how do you decide? For example, you met three companies pretty much in the same technology space. How do you pick the one you actually will write a check?
Well, I suppose it would go back fundamentally to the two other criteria. Who's got, if they're in the same space, is your question?
Yeah.
Well, if they're in the same space, the differentiator, you know what? 9 times out of 10, it comes down to management.
Mm-hmm.
The people, whether you're impressed by them, their background, whether they're too idealistic or a bit more realistic. I have to say that sometimes out here in your neck of the woods, people are a bit blinded by the ideological appeal of one approach or another. In Europe and in the other markets that I'm active in, people are, dare I say it, a bit more practical.
Mm-hmm.
They would like to see, of course, great visionary ideas, but also a bit of experience and a bit of track record in actually performing as a business.
Mm-hmm. Well, because you've been in this business for so many years, you kind of, I'm sure, can categorize the companies you meet and the investors you work with, right? So when somebody just, say, sold the company, made some money, and they decide to become an investor, though there are a lot of, like, many pitfalls.
Yes.
Right? So what is the, like, easiest trap to fall into when you made a bunch of money and you just want to invest in technology companies?
Investing something that you know absolutely nothing about. I think that's probably one of the biggest pitfalls and one of the easiest ones to fall into. I think also companies which are perhaps a little bit too close to home. I know myself, I've lost money on a couple of occasions where I've invested in deals where, you know, it was my good friend X who brought me the deal. And because it was my good buddy, I didn't probably do the amount of due diligence that I would have done if I was taking money from third parties for it.
Right.
So
and
I think those are two easy pitfalls.
You get attached to an idea.
And then you get, you know, then you're invested and you have a tendency to try to support your investments, of course.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But another thing that I think is important too is especially if you're, you know, in a sort of semi-retired category like I am, you know, you need to find something that's fun, that you enjoy doing. And on the positive side, I think that's the positive sort.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at an opportunity and it makes absolutely fantastic financial sense, but doesn't motivate you other than finance, maybe it's not the right thing.
So when we say that the investment money is smart money, what is it that, for example, you personally are prepared to do with the company after you gave them money? Obviously, with your experience, like what will you be doing with the company?
Well, you want to help the company to grow. So it means using your own networks to access additional capital, access additional talent, access additional markets. Mm-hmm. My own specialty is I've always, from a London-based, worked on companies that have got global potential. Mm-hmm. Because London's a very international space. I mean,
now with all those
oh my goodness,
changes.
My dear, don't get me started on Brexit. But let's just say
the problem with Brexit.
I can illustrate, I think, in a politically neutral way, the impact of Brexit. At the moment, the City of London is a financial center that serves a population of 450 million people. Mm-hmm. You know, post-Brexit, it'll be the financial center of an economy with a population of a little less than 70 million people. Mm-hmm. So you tell me where you'd like to be raising money from. So it seems fairly obvious. Nonetheless, London has a number of structural advantages that mean that, especially for U.S. technology-based startups,
right. There's
always going to be an interest in London to good mm-hmm. tech coming from California, as mm-hmm. you and I have seen for over many, many years. Mm-hmm. But my own criteria, in addition to management, markets, and money, is I love to look at companies that have got the ability to go global. That's mm-hmm. That may just be me. A lot of other people may be more domestic.
Right.
But I think if you've got a company in that space, of which there are far more of them here in Silicon Valley than there are, say, in other parts of the world, mm-hmm. The thing that investors need to understand, or that entrepreneurs need to understand, mm-hmm. is that there are, as we speak today, capital markets, money available, investors interested in good technology companies coming from the U.S., they can raise money in London. They can raise money in Tokyo. They can raise money in
right.
Hong Kong. They can raise money in Frankfurt, mm-hmm. in lots of different places.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, that wasn't the case 20 or 30 years ago.
Right.
20, 30 years ago, it was all very domestic.
So when you look at the investment trends, and you understand everything, like obviously globally, because that's what you specialize in, and probably the financial sector is the closest to you in interest, right?
I'm very interested in fintech. I have put far too much of my own money in far too many fintech startups.
What do you see in fintech? Like, would there be any subcategories? Because it's big notion.
Exactly. I think the payments optimization space and competing against the large banks. Mm-hmm. In just about every category.
Mm-hmm.
Just about every category. In Europe, I don't think we have, I don't actually know a single soul who is happy with mm-hmm. the banking services they receive from their day-to-day bank.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that anything that the banks do, the competitors are going to mm-hmm. be able to disrupt that marketplace. I think payments and payment services is a fantastic space. And I think anything that makes the finance experience more user-friendly is going to be a fantastic area of opportunity. For instance, stock markets, IPOs. When's the last time you heard someone say, I did an IPO and everything went swimmingly well? It was so simple. It was so easy.
Something needs to be done with IPOs. It's so expensive. And but what's the alternative? How do investors get exits if it's not M&A or IPO?
Yeah, watch this space. We're working on a couple of solutions to that. But the real answer is by using the new media technologies that are available to allow people to communicate directly with investors and not have to go through traditional regulatorily mandated pinch points.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got a good company.
Mm-hmm.
In the old days, if you wanted to raise money, if you wanted to do an IPO for one of your companies, you'd have to call Merrill Lynch. And Merrill Lynch would have to do an IPO before they could give it to me as a retail investor to invest in. These days, we ought to be able to speak directly. So I think there's a lot of interesting things there.
One more question. If you're an early stage investor, how do you stay in the game throughout the later investment stages.
And avoid dilution?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, there's two ways to look at it. First of all, dilution, a lot of people look at dilution as the devil. You know, dilution's fine as long as your valuation's going up.
Yeah.
So one answer is to not just focus on the dilution issue, but look at the value per share mm-hmm. at which you're being diluted. That's point number one. Point number two is follow your money. Almost every investment agreement from any private equity or venture capital firm in the world has got a non-dilutive clause in there. And so if you really like the company, stay with it.
Stay with it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and keep going. Well,
yep.
Thank you, Ray, so
Thank you
much.
So much. Thank you, Sasha.
Thank you.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Thank you very much, everyone.